guys all for coming. This morning we had the pleasure of hearing a craft talk on Bruce Smith's Literary Mothers. So, Bruce.
Nice. So I'm going to read this with you and play some music and talk about literary mothers. I was one of the great pleasures of teaching graduate students is my graduate student, Naji, in New York, asked me if I would contribute to her blog about literary mothers and influence. So I wrote this piece that I'm going to read with you, and then I'm going to play you a couple songs. I'm going to show you example poems, and I want to finish by 9:35 so you can ask me questions. So here it goes. You can follow along in there. That WHAT is WHAT, the radio station, not what. And it goes like this. Can you see it to follow along? No. Okay, here. I'm going to read it. The radio brought the escaping signals from the Carolinas, bouncing the waves off the ionosphere. Philadelphia was a whistle stop for the Underground Railroad that ran from Sister Rosetta Thorpe to my room. What is that stuff you're listening to? WHAT and WDAS, it makes my liver quiver, the disc jockey said. It made me glow like a vacuum tube in bed, delivering the news of the Black Jesus and the please, 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 and the standard mama jama alto badness, and something that was not self and yet talked to the self, extended the self, and was everything that was other and us. This demon intonation came in the AM frequencies in the form of the voices of Irma Franklin, Etta James, and left-handed Barbara Lynn. It was Irma Franklin, Aretha's oldest sister, who sang Peace of My Heart, later covered by Janis Joplin, and in that invisible voice carried information from the Delta to Detroit to Philly that was, for me, the pattern of lyric poetry. A person in trouble sings. Singing itself is an excess, a wrongness, overcoming the deficiency of talk as communication. When I count literary mothers, I start with these four. And the four are Sister Rosetta Thorpe that I mentioned, Irma Franklin, Etta James, and then Barbara Lynn. And I'm going to play you two examples of that. The big point of that whole little paragraph is a person in trouble sings. And I think that's true for Saskia in Brian's craft talk. A person in trouble, or if not sings, makes dying sounds for the video game. And Jennifer, I was trying to think if that's true for you. A person in trouble sings. It's certainly true for the first excerpt you read, and the grandmother one too, probably. Right? If not in trouble, I don't know. Some imbalance. And I think imbalance is the beginning of story and poetry. You know, you sort of throw yourself out of whack, or something gets out of whack, and then that has to be resolved in the story some way. So part two is says, Mother Me Out of Here, which is a quotation from Theodore Retke. My poetry, Alan Grossman says, in the most literal sense, is the speech of my mother, or rather the completion of the speech of my mother. Literary foremothers have to go through my mother, Josephine Smith, ex-Marine, witness to the Depression and soldier in the Second World War. Yet my mother was a Marine. It's like a joke, you know, you tell people say. But she was both tough-minded and demonstrative, voluble, impassioned. If I complete the speech of my mother, it is with the two poles of poetry in mind, the pragmatic and the sentimental, the ecstatic fire and the sober reality, what I like to call hysteria and haiku, the two poles. Two Emilies, Bronte and Dickinson. Emily Dickinson chose Emily Bronte's poem, No Coward Soul, to be recited at her funeral. No coward souls, these two. Emily Dickinson invented a Protestant duende, and Emily Bronte did the same in Yorkshire, angels who loved the rim of the wound. Dickinson was Vesuvius at home, as in the famous Adrian Rich essay, writing hymns to a god she contested and coaxing out the dragons in the crease. Bronte, through the poems in the medium of Wuthering Heights, gave voice to the unconscious. He's always, always in my mind, not as a pleasure any more than I am always a pleasure to myself, but as my own being. That's a quote from Bronte, from Emily Dickinson. And this one, I love my murderer. Both poets in touch with the shape-shifting, asocial, anarchic nature of the soul. Four, Sonia Sanchez and Nikki Giovanni were literary mothers I wrote about in graduate school. It was the death of me as a graduate student by taking on these people. I brought these old Broadside Press editions from a guy named Dudley Randall in Detroit who did little chapbooks, and that's how Sonia Sanchez and Nikki Giovanni were first published. And regardless of what they have become now, the kind of oracles of love and empowerment, they were in 1968 hand grenades thrown into white maleness. For their punctuation alone, I love them, or their lack of punctuation. Virginia, I'm trying to work in the punctuation thing again, but for their punctures and their piercings. In the rubble of those two, I found Lucille Clifton, quote, I am a black poet, woman poet, and I sound like one. And Audre Lorde, the master's tools will never dismantle the master's house. Five, Emma Goldman says, if I can't dance, I don't want to be part of your revolution. And that seemed to me an echo of Ezra Pound saying, poetry atrophies when it gets too far from music, and music atrophies when it gets too far from dance. And finally, Sugar Every Sugar. Stein, on the centennial of Tender Buttons, because she offered an alternative to male high modernism and an antidote to the failure of erotic potential. So I'm going to play you two songs and then talk particularly about, there's a kind of a half reveal that I'm gonna do right now. So a person in trouble sings or someone in trouble sings. Will this stay down? No, oh yeah. And so here's two examples from the first. I do wanna stop and encourage you to go to this site and submit your own literary mothers. I got permission to do that from them. And they, if you go and they go under frequently asked questions, it'll say, one of them is, I'm a beginning writer and could I submit to literary mothers? And then they're encouraging you there on the site. So yeah, 500 words to literary mothers. You can have your own literary mothers. And you can go to the archive and there's really interesting people that are there. I'm going to play you two. This is Rosetta Tharpe in Manchester, England. Tim Craven's, close to Tim Craven's. So Chuck Berry learned everything from Sister Rosetta Tharpe. He stole everything. I'm going to stop her there. And I'm going to show you Aretha Franklin's older sister, Irma. Upper mid-screen. So my idea is that the poem, for me, and I don't want to really continue about sort of my literary mothers, but talk about sort of like the origin of this whole enterprise that we're here this week to talk about. And I think, for me, it's really Someone in Trouble Sings. And the packet you have, if you can go to maybe the back pages of them, show you it's like some of the sort of original Someone's in well, no, wait, sorry. It's, I'm looking for the page that has at the top, Someone in Trouble Sings. I guess it's the third page in, or third from the middle, in the middle there somewhere. So this, having trouble. Oh, there it is. So this is Catullus from his song number 85, and I have various translations of it, and I'll give you one that I think is sort of a flat one. This first one: I hate and I love. You may well ask why I do so. I do not know, but I feel it and suffer. And the last two are these kind of radical translations of it by Frank Bidart, who did, in two different books, did it twice. And it goes like this: I hate and love. The sleepless body hammering a nail, nails itself, hanging crucified. And then my favorite one, the last one: I hate and love, ignorant fish, who even wants the fly while writhing. So Someone in Trouble Sings. I think, you know, the stories that we've heard, you know, share that in common. There's some difficulty, there's some trouble, and out of that comes the song. And for me, the second kind of idea, and maybe I'll just show you this other it's not a craft talk until I do the Emily Dickinson part, you know. So this is Dickinson 443, right under the Catullus. And whatever you know about Emily Dickinson, or whatever you learned in high school, is probably wrong, as it was, you know, as was for me. And she did spend the last 15 years of her life in her father's house, sort of upstairs. My favorite story is she had a medical examination. A doctor came to the house to examine her, and she walked upstairs between her sister's room and her room, and the doctor stood at the bottom of the stairs. That was it. That was her idea of sociability. She was not exactly the mad woman in the attic, but she did spend the last 15 years there. But she had this intense private life, and her story really is Someone in Trouble Sings. And I think you'll see this in this poem, which I think moves, I'll just describe it a little bit, which is she's doing sort of the, what I would call the womanly duties of somebody who lives by herself in 1860 in Amherst, Massachusetts, in Main Street, tying her hat, creasing her shawl. But there's a, you know, kind of a great interior. So it goes like this. I tie my hat, I crease my shawl, life's little duties do precisely, as the very least were infinite to me. I put new blossoms in the glass and throw the old away. I push a petal from my gown that anchored there. I weigh the time 'twill be till 6 o'clock. I have so much to do, and yet existence some way back stopped, struck my tickling through. We cannot put ourselves away as a completed man or woman. When the errand's done, we came to flesh upon. There may be miles on miles of naught, of action, sicker far to simulate. Its sting is stinging work to cover what we are from science and from surgery. Two telescopic eyes to bear on us unshaded for their sake, not for ours. 'Twould start them. We could tremble. But since we got a bomb and held it in our bosom, nay, hold it, it is calm. Therefore, we do life's labor, though life's reward be done with scrupulous exactness to hold our senses on. So it's a poem that starts with, you know, putting on a hat and has a bomb in it in the middle of it, you know, somewhere. Someone in Trouble Sings. And I want to show you just kind of the other things that I sort of derived from listening to the, at first the Literary Mothers, and then extending to the other people. One is this idea of the voice, because I think there, the French writer and critic Helene Cissou says that she talks about in her essays the tongue laved with saliva in the mouth, you know, and it kind of originates there. And it reminded me of Donald Hall's kind of essay about the pleasures of poetry, and the essay is called Goatfoot, Milk Tongue, and Twin Bird. Goatfoot being the pleasure of dance and rhythm, especially the childish pleasure of just movement and dance. Milk tongue, the pleasure of words in the mouth. As you know, like every child likes to do that. Blah, blah, blah. I'd sit in, you know, all day and make those noises. That's milk, that's what he calls milk tongue. And twin bird, can you guess twin bird? It's actually the pleasures of form or symmetry or pattern that's picked up in the child in the crib by having these two birds fly around in front of them, and then they're somehow twinning and independent from her and yet, you know, part of her. So for me, the voice Like, what was that about those singers that came in the radio that was so powerful and so potent? The voice. It's something, in addition to what Pound says there's really these three ideas in poetry. Forgive me, because I talked about this a little yesterday, too. He said there was these three elements of poetry, and I'll give you the fancy words so you can impress your friends. You come home from the conference using these words, you'll be really, really make a difference. Phanapoeia, which is just from our word phantom, the ability to cast an image. So it's the image and thing, the thinginess of it. No ideas but in things kind of stuff. Melopoeia, which is what I'm really going to talk about, which is kind of the acoustical elements of poetry. The soundtrack. The poem would be different if it didn't have the soundtrack. That's why it's always difficult to say what your poem is about. Because, it's about making some sounds come out. It comes from, melody. And then Pound says there was this other element, logopoeia, which he said was the dance of the intellect among the language. But for me, there's other quality, which is the quality of voice, which was contained in these singers that I heard on that big maroon transistor that we thought was such a great, miraculous, portable invention. It was this big. So the voice for me is the other thing that happens there, kind of in the way of a soliloquy in which the speaker at one point comes up to the edge of the stage, and says, tomorrow, tomorrow, and tomorrow, or speaks like directly to the audience. And the great example of that, I think, for me is in the 20th century, in the 21st century, is Louis Glick, who has these miraculous sort of a person in trouble speaking, especially openings, and that's the first page. And it starts, the untrustworthy speaker, don't listen to me, my heart's been broken. And that's, isn't that a killer opening? Of course you want to listen. The person that says, don't listen to me, and my heart's been broken on the same line, that's really interesting information. We want to voyeuristically pay attention to that stuff. I'm going to read the rest of it for you. I don't see anything objectively. It kind of reverses the idea of lyric poetry in a way, which is kind of like Glick, because he's such a contradictory, bitter person that I love that about her. She's usually saying, the lyric poem says, I have, my heart's been broken, listen to me, I have a son. That's the troubadours, that's what the troubadours, they went around southern France singing, saying, listen to me, my heart's broken, I'm pursuing this woman and she won't pay attention to me. But she says, don't listen to me, I don't see anything objectively. I know myself, I've learned to hear like a psychiatrist. When I speak passionately, that's when I'm least to be trusted. It's very sad, really. All my life, I've been praised for my intelligence, my powers of language, of insight. In the end, they're wasted. I never see myself standing on the front steps, holding my sister's hand. That's why I can't account for the bruises on her arm with the sleeve ends. In my own mind, I'm invisible. That's why I'm dangerous. People like me who seem selfless, we're the cripples, the liars. We're the ones who should be factored out in the interest of truth. When I'm quiet, that's when the truth emerges. A clear sky, the clouds like white fibers. Underneath a little gray house, the azaleas red and bright pink. If you want the truth, you have to close yourself to the older daughter, block her out. When a living thing is hurt like that, in its deepest workings, all function is altered. That's why I'm not to be trusted, because a wound to the heart is also a wound to the mind. And maybe I'm gonna give you homework to read the rest of this Larry Levis poem, which is a really favorite of mine. But it's also a great, somebody who's receiving songs, hearing voices, I guess that's another definition of what poets do. Whenever I listen to Billie Holiday, I am reminded that I, too, was once banished from New York City. That, and I'll stop there. The other thing about the song and the voice, particularly, I always think of Whitman, who loved the voice going at full tilt in the opera. You know, he was an attendee of all the two different kinds of opera that were available to him in New York City in 1860, 1864. And he loved that voice going at full tilt, that orbic flex of the tenor's mouth, he says in Song of Myself. So the expressive part of it, certainly, you know, that passionate, expressive part of it, the lamp, not the mirror, to use that sort of that old trope of Abrams, his book, The Mirror and the Lamp. Who wanted a mirror, you know, in your bedroom in Philadelphia? Who wanted to, like, a reflection of what you were? You don't want that. You want something that's going to burn the house down. You want Irma Franklin to be singing there, you know, and screaming, and James Brown saying, please, 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 for 7 minutes. You know, that you didn't want the mirror. You wanted something else. It's something that was going out there. And yet, if in that case, then lyric poetry, the best poem would be, oh God. It would be just expressive, or oh shit, you know. It would be just the expressive thing. And, you know, and Keats talks about that. It's not self-expression. It's something else. It has this form, for instance, in both of the songs, Rosetta Thorpe's and in Irma Franklin. You know, it has these beats and phrases and repetition that Hope and you and I were talking about. It comes around again, and that's why good songs like good poems you want to hear again. You don't say, like John Cage said, when they asked him if he wanted to go to a symphony, he said, I've already been to a symphony. You know, so he, you know, and you don't say that about poetry. You don't say, oh, I heard that poem, bro. You say that poem, like recite that poem again. I want to learn that poem by heart, or turn that shit up. You know, I got to hear that song again. You know, that Irma Franklin thing. And then the other thing that I think is interesting, and I've been more and more coming to this, is the songs have for me a crypto-historical burden. They do for Sister Rosetta Thorpe, born in Mississippi and came to Chicago. And that, is a deeply sort of historical moment in American history that we don't often think about. And the Franklins, with their connection to gospel music and the blues, and in Amiri Baraka's book, The Blues People, you know, he talks about that. And I think that's not what you hear. You hear the song, but I think there's, you know, a hidden sort of historical burden to all of that. A little early, but I wanted to, I actually did want to stop, because I think the sort of the best part of these craft talks is the exchanges where you can ask me stuff if you want. And I know you're proud or tired, but do you have a question or two? I should have read the rest of the Larry Levis poem. Take a.
Do you do it now?
I think Larry Levis is the hands-on, Tim, I don't know if I'm right about this, like the hands-on favorite of MFA students at everywhere, like everywhere I go, they say, yeah, what are you reading? I'm reading Larry Levis, and, you know, there'll be two others. And I'm trying to catch up a little bit with that. Do you know Larry Levis, his work at all? And maybe you will after this one. So here, my story in a late style of fire. So first of all, that's a killer title. You know, that's a great title. Whenever I listen to Billie Holiday, I am reminded that I too was once banished from New York City, not because of drugs or because I was interesting enough for any wan, overworked patrolman to worry about. his expression usually a great gauzy spider web of bewilderment over his face. I was banished from New York City by a woman. Sometimes, after we had stopped laughing, I would look at her and see a cold note of sorrow or puzzlement go over her face as if someone else were there behind it, not laughing at all. We were, I think, in love. No, I'm sure. If my house burned down tomorrow morning, and if I and my wife and son stood looking on at the flames, and if then someone stepped out of the crowd of bystanders and said to me, "Didn't you once know?" No. But if one of the flames, rising up in a scherzo of fire, turned all the windows blank with light, and if that flame could speak, and if it said to me, "You loved her, didn't you?" I'd answer, hands in my pockets, "Yes." And then I'd let fire and misfortune overwhelm my life. Sometimes, remembering those days, I watch a warm, dry wind bothering a whole line of elms and maples along a street in this neighborhood until they're all moving at once, until I feel just like them, trembling and in unison. Bothering is a great word, isn't it there? None of this matters now, but I never felt alone all that year. And if I had sorrows, I also had laughter, the affliction of angels and children, which can set a whole house on fire if you'd let it. And even then, you might still laugh to see all of your belonging set you free in one long choiring of flames that sang only to you, either because no one else could hear them or because no one else wanted to, and mostly because they know. They know such music cannot last and that it would tear them apart if they listened. In those days, I was in fact already married, just as I am now, although to another woman. And that day, I could have stayed in New York. I had friends there. I could have stayed, could have strayed up Lexington Avenue and down to Third and caught a faint glistening of the sea between the buildings. But all I wanted was to hold her all morning until her body was again a bright field, or until we both reached some thicket as if at the end of a lane or at the end of all desire, and where we could, therefore, be alone again and make some dignity out of loneliness, as mostly people cannot do. Billie Holiday, whose life was shorter and more humiliating than my own, would have understood all this, if only because even in her late addiction and her bloodstream's hallelujahs, she too sang often of some affair or someone gone and therefore permanent. And sometimes she sang for nothing, even then, and it isn't anyone's business if she did. That morning, when she asked me to leave wearing only the apricot-tinted fraying chemise, I wanted to say, but I also wanted to go, to lose her suddenly almost for no reason, and certainly without any expectation. I remember looking down at a pair of singular tracks made in a light snow the night before, and how they were gradually effacing themselves beneath the tires of the morning traffic, and thinking that my only other choice was fire, ashes, abandonment, solitude, all of which happened anyway, and soon after, and by divorce. I know this isn't much, but I wanted to explain this life to you, even if I had to become, over the years, someone else to do it. You have to think of me, you have to think of me what you think of me. I had to live my life, even its late florid style. Before you judge this, think of her, then think of fire, its laughter, the music of splintering beams and glass, the flames reaching through the second story of a house, almost as if to mistakenly rescue someone who left you years ago. It is so American, fire, so like us, its desolation and its eventual brief triumph. So I think that's got it all. It's got logopoeia, it's got the dance of the intellect going in it. It's got sort of music, and the music is sort of a charged, important speaking, Frank O'Hara style in New York, you know, Pac-Man style, proceeding by gobbling up the next thing, you know, that it has to. And it also has these you know, arresting, amazing images, which are, you know, the sort of the fire images for me in the poem. Yeah, so I'm exhausted now reading that. I have to take a nap now. No class. Go to the swimming pool early. Do you have a question or two? I have to have water. But ask me a question, so.
I have a really boring question.
Yeah.
What is the URL for the Literary Mothers Commission?
Oh, what does URL mean? No, it's it's literary.
It's like a little white bar.
Yeah, it's just, it's. I'll put it up again. Literary Mothers. Whoops. Yeah. And there's an archive that you should, that I'm gonna get for you here. And you really can't see it because it's too small, but it has sort of a lot of contemporary people and authors as well. Deb Olin Unferth on Gertrude Stein, which I thought was a really good one, but contemporary writers and older writers. Tracy Levine is a Syracuse MFA on Mary Gateskill. And I think it's interesting. And I'm encouraging you once again to submit 500 words on your Literary Mothers to the site and tell Naji I sent you when you write. Why not do that? You know, you write 500 words, you know, it'll be my Literary Mothers are, you know, so you can claim it. Yes?
Two questions, one of which is relevant to this, the other is quite boring, even more so than...
More boring than a URL, man, that's really, what, no.
First question. Never meant it to be, just saying as a caveat. The Literary Mothers blog, is that open to prose or is it just poetry that you can see?
No. A lot of prose writers. I see Kay Ryan, but a lot of prose writers as well. You know, Marguerite Duras, Susan Howe, Hilary Mantel, that's a poet person, Jenny Ophill, her book called Department of Speculation, novelist there, Christine Schutt, who's, you know, written about, so yeah, and you, there's a, sorry, this is even... to the archive, going back. But there's a submit, and there it is. Oh no, there's some experience problems with the submission page, but it tells you how to do it. And I thought maybe you would, you know, you could generate something of your own. Does anyone have a literary mother that they want to tell me about? When a claim, when a voice.
Jane Kramer.
Yeah, I think she's, there's someone who else wrote about her, so you have to see it.
If I'm just making a pretty straightforward sense of somebody who I really feel taught me how to write a particular kind of, I don't know her.
Yeah.
But when I was trying to do intelligent, condensed, journalism.
Yeah.
Reading her stuff about Europe from in the New Yorker. I sort of shamelessly threw myself on her style.
Yeah. You should write. You should claim that.
Did you ask yourself a question?
Oh, don't worry about it.
What would be the most essential distinction, if any, between a literary mother and a literary father?
So the literary father, that's an excellent question. So the literary father, I mean, because I could have done a literary father, because I think there's, You know, I do believe there's a kind of an Oedipal struggle with the literary father. You know, Eliot says every generation has to kill their fathers to have their own identity. So for me, I was talking about sort of the more devotional, the people that I was sort of loved, rather than the ones that I was felt I was killing and then eating, so, you know, to become the buffalo, you know.
So one's relationship to one's literary mother or father depends on one's own gender?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm a kind of believing that about, like, I'm reading a lot of Adam Phillips, the British psychologist now. Tim knows I only talk about Adam Phillips all the time now. And I think, you know, and C. Seuss too, the kind of that Freudian stuff seems interesting to me after it's been sort of cleaned out of all its sexism, but then re-examined as kind of the identity struggles and sexual research, he calls it, you know, that goes on in writing too. So yeah, I would say yeah. Is that, are people gonna come kill me in my bed?
I have a kind of a funny thing happen, because as you were talking, I thought of William Butler Yeats, and it was the Crazy Jane poems, and of course where he has the persona of a woman.
Right.
It's I must lie down where all the ladders.
Yeah.
In the fall rag and.
Right. Yeah. Bone chop of the heart.
And that's literary mother for me.
Yeah.
But it's cross gender.
Yeah.
Really
think
about it. So I don't know that gender has anything to do with it, finally.
Okay, maybe I'm saying that.
Mm. Men mother also. Men mother also.
Yeah.
In their wisdom.
Yeah.
Age.
Yeah. When they're dead. Yeah. But that's helpful. And I'm also reminded of Grace Paley's saying that every writer must become a woman. And I think she meant that you have to be receptive. You have to, you know, sort of take in, rather than the kind of the trope that's from Shakespeare, which is Prospero going out with his wand and his book, making stuff happen, creating storms. And, you know, at the end of that play, he throws away his book and his wand, his male symbol, sort of. And he becomes, in my mind, it's a play about single parenting. And he becomes a mother to his daughter, right? And every third thought was going to be his death. So he becomes the in that way he becomes the Grace Paley person.
Well, he frees Ariel.
Yeah.
That's freeing the imagination, essentially, to not serve you, your purposes.
Yeah.
To come.
What about Caliban? The historical burden, the crypto-historical burden of the song there. Yes?
Hi, I'm Chris Gonzalez. I'm sorry I have to explain a little bit about who I am before I ask my question.
Sure.
So I'm a memoirist.
Yeah.
And I suppose I have a literary mother, a mother who's written many books and has self-published them and maybe does not have a lot of readers.
So a real literary mother, yeah.
But I've chosen to write about my father, and I use my mother's books as a way of understanding her fictional characters and the kind of fictional ideas that she had about my father.
Right.
And I'm kind of curious, you know, so about your title. In my books, like, my mother is a novelist, but her fictional characters kind of get mixed up with my memories of who my parents really were, so kind of a literary device. But your title, Examining Bruce's Literary Mothers, an attempt to look at both the influence and establishing of a body of work. And body of work is in quotes.
You're a poet.
So you have to be aware that you have body in there. How are women's bodies of work different than men's?
Well, I really contributed to the Literary Mother site because I was convinced by my student Najee's site that the purpose of it was, you know, she originated the site because she felt in very urgently that women novelists particularly were being dropped from, do you know about this? The Google, they were being actually taken and put in a category called women novelists. So they weren't on the list of novels. So you, there's more, what?
It was on Wikipedia.
And Wikipedia is kind of thing. So that, I think that was the origin of it. So that, and then I'm a sort of a contributing member to VIDA, which is the group, as you might know about VIDA, which is a group of started by my friend Erin Ballou, who's at Florida State, which sort of keeps track about women getting book reviews in the various magazines and publishes, at the end of the year, sort of that. It's a, I don't know about the statistical part of that, but that was the, I don't know if I'm getting near your question, but that was the, and I didn't want to see that sort of that. I think you create the body of work by being reviewed, being talked about, claiming literary mothers, writing about that, writing, contributing to, 500 words to the site. So that was the important thing about the body of work. And then I was doing a little meta-textual thing with the quotations. Yeah, does that get close to it? I'm interested to read your memoir about that, because that's an interesting lever and mechanism to get into the father through the mother's, through the mother's.
So my mother wrote journals and diaries and books, and my father didn't really write anything. So I kind of have the reverse.
Yeah, right.
My specific family experience is sort of the opposite of our culture.
Do you think that you speak in your mother's voice, like Alan Grossman says? Alan Grossman says, my poetry in the most literal sense is the speech of my mother, or rather the completion of the speech of my mother.
Maybe, yeah. I mean, maybe, the reason I'm writing about my father is sort of like sharing grief with my mother over his loss.
I mean, Rita Dove says this too. She has in her poems, her adolescence poems, she has three, I think, really great adolescence, 1, 2, and 3. And she talks about the unlived life of the child is the greatest, or the unlived life of the parent is the greatest burden for the child. And, so she has these, particularly Adolescence 2. Do you know Adolescence 2? It's a really great, because, I'm pointing to you because you're saying yes to the unlived life of the parent.
My God,
yeah. So, my mother was a Marine. She wanted to be a dancer on Steel Pier in Atlantic City. And that was her unlived life. So maybe that's, I became an artist, for that reason. 10:09:50. Oh, question. Now you have a question.
I know I share one with her mother.
Yeah, good. Oh, yeah. Thank you.
She actually, she wrote a very interesting, it was one of her talks or one of her essays where she spoke about, this must be a long time ago, but she talked about how she went to a writer's convention and all the writers, the male writers, were having fits over being asked who was an influence on their writing, and they basically that's just like the most hated question. Nobody wanted to talk about it. And then she went to this women's writers convention, and they were all looking for women writers whom they could claim as ancestors. And so it was this completely opposite emotional connection and behavior, and it reminded me of things that you said earlier.
My beloved Jules Gibbs, who's going to read here on Wednesday, a little plug for her, but she has Native American ancestors, and she's always investigating kinship models and tribal associations, and that for her is sort of informed her work in that same kind of way. So thanks very much. Go to class.